Morning everyone, Nick from Meat Smoke Fire here. It is week, who knows what. So I think it's week 20 or 21 of these cooks, so that's not bad going. So three cooks for you today. Yeah, three. We're gonna do some Thai style mussels. So we're gonna use a cast iron pan for that. We're gonna do some sea bass two ways. We're gonna do one on a plank because people have asked to see that, and we'll do a bit of salmon with that as well. And we're also going to do some sea bass in a cast iron pan, a cast iron plancha. You'll see a bit of a theme here. And then we are going to cook a vegetable dish, some fennel with roasted tomatoes, and we're going to do that in a cast iron pan. So today's theme is cast iron, pretty much. So I've got this splendid specimen here. You might want to look at that, Andy. So if your cast iron looks as bad as mine, don't fret. We're gonna try and make this one look.
Morning.
Andy's on the camera. She surprised us this morning and rocked up. So she's here to do the camera. And we've got Helena over here, as usual, typing away on the iPad.
Morning.
So she'll be doing all of that for you. So there you go, Andy. Right. Let's get straight to it. So this vegetable dish I'm going to get on first. It's the one that's going to take the longest. We want it to roast. We've got an egg sitting here, a little bit warm, just over 200. I want it about 180, 200, so I'll knock it down a little bit. We are going to roast off the fennel and the tomatoes. So let's get over here, Andy. So I have Big Green Eggs cast iron skillet, the small one. I love these. We are going to just pop a bit of olive oil in there, light olive oil in the bottom. And then we're going to put in some fennel. So take the tops off these little frong bits, keep them. We're going to chuck those on at the end. But what we're going to do with this fennel is we're just going to slice it lengthways. So into about 5 millimeter thick. Just be careful when you're doing this. And that is all the prep we need of that fennel. So I'll pop it into this pan on the bottom. And what we want to do is get that in there at about 180 degrees and it will start to caramelize. To that, we are going to add some of these beautiful Italian tomatoes. So I'm going to cut them fairly chunky into long bits. I'll add them on there. Get them in and get them roasting. Of course, it's me. I'm going to add some molten salt. Not too much, but it will pull out that flavour of those tomatoes. It's going to be a really simple dish, this. And at the end, we'll put some lemon over it to take that. We've got the sweetness from the tomatoes, we've got the saltiness from the sugar. And we'll get the acidic flavour from the lemon. So we'll put that in at the end, so we'll squeeze that over. But for now, these can go in and start caramelising those fennel. So, all I've got in here, just got the expander kit. I could have it either layer, I've got it at the top, and I'm gonna pop it on the middle. It's a direct cook, and that shall start to get that nice and warm. Okay, so while that's cooking, let's go and do some maintenance. Loads of people have contacted me about their cast iron, worrying about, you know, they've got a cast iron pan that they've neglected over the winter. Get yourself some foil, scrunch it up, and then just rub it around this pan. So we'll do the inside. Sorry, it's a bit noisy. And then we'll flip it over and we'll do the outside. And all I'm doing is knocking off the worst of this rust. Now you could do this with a scouring pad as well, but foil works perfectly and it's cheap as chips. Right, that'll do me. I'll put that out, I'll do the lid afterwards. you will get grubby. Get yourself some paper towel and dry it if it's wet like mine. So if you look in there, Andy, that's nice and dry now. And then I'm just going to grab some some vegetable oil. 1 second, put it on the wrong table. Get a bit of veg oil, get it in there, and just rub it round your pan. Now you can already see, it's already looking 1,000 times better. We'll flip it over, we'll get the outside as well. Bit of veg oil on there. I'm not going to labour this too much, but you get the idea. Got lots of oil in there, well, not a lot of oil, but just knock the worst of the rust off. Now we've got a nice hot egg here. This one's about 250. So I'm going to burp it. I'm going to find a cooking surface for it. Let me just grab the one that's in here. And we'll pop that on there. I'll do the lid at another time, but we'll pop that on there. And we're just going to give that a whole load of heat now. Warm it up, get that oil to burn in there, and then it'll smoulder off, and that will start to season it. Now, what we're going to have to do is do that a couple of times, so we'll come back to this in a few minutes. Just going to wash these. So, Helena, any questions? Who have we got on? Any shout-outs?
We've got Karen on this morning.
Karen.
True Love.
Karen True Love on. Hi, Karen.
Isabel,
morning.
Ben.
Morning, Ben. Are you on your tractor this morning? Look at that, I've got rust in.
Tea.
Tea's on. Morning tea. You baking today, tea?
I just asked if anyone's got a hangover. We've got one person with a hangover.
Who's got a hangover? They got a funny handle.
James Fry. James, John.
Hangover's going on. Good, we like that. Hopefully you're all tired and ready for a weekend of cooking. The weather's going to be stunning. That's what we want. Right, they're a bit better. Right, what should we do next? Should we get these mussels going? They're going to be ready a bit early. They'll go, well, we'll see. Yeah, let's get on with it. Right, different cast iron pan. That's what that one up there will start to look like when we've seasoned it. So this is one I've already seasoned. This isn't a big green egg one. This is a lodge one. I just picked it today. I bought this in lockdown. But I just wanted to use it, otherwise I could have used one of these two. So we've got different models. I particularly like baking with this one, the little big green egg one. You've seen me do the sourdough on that. But great cast iron pans, and then there's a big oval one if you're doing chilies and that sort of thing. It's got leaves in it. You never know in our house. Right, so we're gonna cook in this little lodge cast iron pan. So eggs about 180-200. I've got direct again, so if you have a look in there, Andy. We've got just the grid at the lower level. I've got the expander system. All I'm gonna do is pop that in there, start warming that up, and I'm gonna put some groundnut oil in. So just a little bit of groundnut in the bottom, warm that up. 2 or 3 tablespoons. Get that started to warm up. So that's going to take 2 or 3 minutes. The idea is we're going to use that. We're going to fry off some, we've got some shallots, we've got some garlic, ginger. We've got some garlic, we've got some chilies, we've got some lemongrass, and we're going to fry all of those off. And then we're going to pop the mussels in. And then we're going to add the bits that make it Thai, or a lot of the things that make it Thai. Fish sauce, some palm sugar, some lime juice, some coconut milk, and then coriander and some basil, Thai basil. So we'll get all of those in there. So let's get that warmed up. So are there any questions, Helena?
No.
Come on, people, ask questions. That's why we're here. A bit of an exciting week this week. We've had, you may not know him, but Tim Hayward. He is a food writer, he's a restaurateur, so he owns a restaurant in Cambridge, Fitzbillies, which we love. He writes the book Food DIY, which I've linked on my website in the book review. It's one of my favourites in terms of curing and all of that stuff. He bought one of the rotisseries from me this week, so I got to go over and deliver it and meet him and tell him about what we do here. So next year when we're back doing live classes, he wants to come and do a demo of chopping up big bits of meat. So we'll probably maybe tie that in with Miles from the Gogs as well, and that will be a one-off class. So I don't know how we're going to work that out, how we work out who gets to go on that one. But Tim is he's a right character. I first bumped into him when he was doing a blog or he was tweeting about Grill Stop, which was taking place in Bristol, and it was just the funniest event of how all these judges, he was on a judging team to judge the barbecue. This team basically had gone out on the Saturday night with the Sunday coming up and got absolutely blotto. And this, all the tweets were about him getting up the next morning and finding it, you know, not knowing where he was. And it was just hilarious. So that's how I first bumped into him. Anyway.
Okay.
Oh, you've got a question?
Yes.
Okay, I'll wait a minute then. So Darren has said, my egg is throwing up embers when I burp it. So when you open it and the embers are jumping out, typically it's one of two things. Slightly damp charcoal. When your charcoal is a little bit damp, it will spit. It's as the moisture in the charcoal expands to become steam, and then it blows the charcoal apart and you get bits shooting out at you. It's a sign of good airflow though. So that's that your egg's clean. That's a good thing. So it might be damp charcoal, and it also might be poor quality charcoal. There are certain brands out there that tend to spit more than others. It tends to be the stuff that's made of a lighter wood than some of the others. So if you pick up Big Green Egg stuff, it's quite dense. You pick up other bags of charcoal the same size and it will weigh a lot less. Those ones tend to spit a lot more. So it might be the charcoal you're using, or it might be your charcoal's got slightly damp. Right. Thanks for that. That was a good question. Right, we're going to go in with our shallots. So these are just banana shallots. Get a nice little fry in there. We're going to go in with the garlic and the chilli. So there's about two cloves of garlic and one of my homegrown chilies, which I haven't even tried yet. So this will be interesting. They're from my friend Ballon down the road. We're going to go in with a bit of ginger and that lemongrass. So I've just chopped it up, stick of lemongrass, chopped up finely. We're going with those, and we're going to give that a good whir around. So give that a couple of minutes just to soften up. Okay, so it sounded like Helena had another question.
Yeah, Karen is going to attempt doing Yorkshire pudding tomorrow on the egg.
Oh, yeah, I'm not an expert. No, tips for Yorkshire pudding, get your pan really nice and hot. So egg 200, 220 maybe, put your pan in there, get your oil in there, it's exactly the same as the oven, get it in there, get your oil so it's piping hot, and then tip your Yorkshire pudding mixture in there. It, just be careful as you do it, you might want to take your pan out, or you just might want to put a pair of gloves on. They're still on Amazon. You needed to be here for last week for that. But yeah, just half fill your the cups that you're going to put them into, half fill it, and they then should rise. But keep your egg nice and hot, that's the key to it. The guy to ask is Callum Slade, who lives down in Kent. He always cooks his Yorkshires on the egg and they always look amazing. And he's, you know, he wouldn't say to you he's a brilliant cook, but his Yorkshires look incredible. So ask Callum if it doesn't work out. Right. Can you reverse sear on cast iron? Absolutely. If I'm cooking a steaks or something like that, I prefer to do the sear bit on cast iron. I love cooking on cast iron surfaces. So yeah, absolutely. Right, let's have a little look at what's going on in this one. So it's bubbling away. Let's see if we're getting any color yet. Not yet. What we're trying to do is brown these off a little bit. So this one's going to be a bit of a rush in this class, but yeah, normally you want to do it a little bit slower, but we're trying it. It might not work, we're trying it. Right, back here, Andy. Right. So. They're all softened up nicely. This is one of the fastest and most delicious dishes. So we're going to get everything else in there pretty much. So I'm going to get some coconut milk and open that. I didn't open it beforehand because I knew I'd knock it over if I did. So watch me spill it now. Right, got that. Let's go. Let's get our mussels in there. They've just been washed, de-bearded. Get some coconut milk in there. That's a lot of coconut milk, but that's fine. We'll give, let those, that's going to take a couple of minutes to warm up and get those to open up. At that point, then we're going to put in some the rest of the ingredients. So we've got Thai basil, which you can get from Asian supermarkets. We'll put some squeezed lime in there, and some fish sauce, and some sugar, and then we'll garnish with a bit of coriander. So we'll give that a couple of minutes. Let's go and have a look at that pot in the end.
Okay, someone's asked, can you use the same process to clean up
your cast iron grill? So the question has been, can you use the same process clean up your cast iron grills? Absolutely. Just rub them. You'll see probably under the all of these tables there's normally balls of foil. I use it on everything. So this one's not quite hot enough yet. What I might do on this, in fact, I don't know why I've put the expander in, it's because I'm not used to cooking with anything else at the moment. I've just put that, the normal grill, since I've got one, a bit lower. Get that in there, get a bit of heat to this. You can see it starting to dry out a little bit, so we'll get a tiny bit more oil up the sides. And then here, open it up a bit more at the bottom. But can you see it's looking, you know, already starting to look like a much better pan. I think it needs a bit more around the outside. So I'll balance it on here. Just take care when you're doing this. These things are incredibly warm. Get a bit of that, let's close that, get it warmed up. Bit of oil on here. Put my glove back on. See, this pan is soaking that oil in so quickly. But it's taken all of that rust off. There we go. Pop that back in, give it a bit more heat. That's all there is to it. Right, let's go and have a look at our mussels. Testing Andy's backward skills in the flip-flops. Right. Give them a stir. You see them starting to open, some of these now. Getting nice and hot. Couple more minutes on those. Right, while they're doing, let's talk about our fish. How are we doing for time? Good. So, in this one, we have our, we're gonna put our fish in here as well. So we've got our just starting to colour. What I'm going to do is put this a bit lower and we'll put the fish stuff above it, I think. So we will take this one off. This is the beauty of the expander system, is that you can make adjustments if you need to. So we'll take that, get in there, keep going with that a bit lower, that will give it a bit more heat. And then I'm going to do above it, I will go and grab another surface. And above it, we are going to put the salmon and the sea bass. So give me one sec to get another surface. Yeah. He's going to use. Okay. Oh, nice. Haven't tried that one. So duck. Ian's doing duck breast on the let's queue in a flat basket, and so he's going to spin that basket. Duck breast, you want at quite a high heat, so I'd go 250 maybe. It's fatty, so do be careful. That duck breast fat is going to drip out. It will hit the coals, and when you open your egg, you are going to get flare-ups. Definitely crisscross the skin to let it render. Put a lot of fat on the skin side. Did he say duck breasts?
Yeah.
So yeah, definitely put crisscross, probably about a 5mm crisscross onto the skin, salt on there, and then when you spin it, it should crisp up nicely. You want to take really a duck breast to probably medium rare, so 57 degrees. So I would take it off the egg when the internal temperature of the duck breast is about 50 degrees. And you could just use a thermopen to, you know, stop the motor, plug that in, wait to see if it's 50 degrees. If it is, then take it off. And as it rests, put it in a bit of foil, put them individually in foil. And as you rest them, the outside layers, which are a lot hotter than 50 degrees, and the middle that's less, a lot hotter than 57 degrees, and the middle that's a lot lower than 57 degrees, they will equalize. That's what resting is. And hopefully you'll end up around 57 degrees. Two or three degrees either side will be absolutely spot on. So yeah. Interested, post the photos, tag me at Meat Smoke Fire in that one. Want to see that? Love that idea. I normally do it on a cast iron, but yeah, like it. Right, so I've just put that pan a lower level. The point of that is I want to use this upper level to cook on a plank. So I'm just going to flip over these over now. Starting to get a little bit of color, they're drying out. Those tomatoes are starting to melt, which is what we're after. Now, if you're not a big fennel fan, try it. It loses that aniseed, and the tomatoes give it a load of sweetness. It is just delicious. It goes so well with fish. So do try this. This is, by the way, is a dish from it's been stolen a couple of times, I guess. I've stolen it from Mark at Smoked Fine Food. So look him up online. He's Mark_SmokedFineFood on Instagram, or he's smokedfinefood.co.uk. Look him up. I think he stole it from Genevieve Taylor, who wrote the excellent cookbook Charred, which is another book that I think is linked on my book review. It's all vegetarian and it's superb. So yeah, have a look at that.
So right. Another question.
Yes, go. How easy is it to cook a lamb shoulder overnight without a temp controller? That really depends on how confident you are about getting your egg to set temperature. Right, I'll come back to that. I want to get onto this, otherwise we're going to overcook this. So we're going to put some Thai basil in there. In fact, I'm going to just rip it up a little bit. Get some of that in there. That will give it a lovely basil lemon flavour. We're going to put about 2 tablespoons of fish sauce in there. We are going to go for, I'm probably going to go for what's left now, palm sugar. Get it in there. Lovely. And we will come back for the lime in a second. We'll just give that a stir through. Do you want all that palm sugar to dissolve? And while that's just finishing up, I'm going to come and cut some coriander, so we'll go back.
So, another quick question.
So, we haven't finished the lamb shoulder yet. So, lamb shoulder overnight. I'm just going to take a little bunch, scrunch it up. Stalks and all. Stalks are fabulous. They've got a lot of flavour. So, the lamb shoulder. That'll do me. Key with any overnight cook, make sure your egg has equalizing temperature, so it's stable. So get your egg to 110 with all your surfaces in there and make sure you're happy it's at that temperature and it's sitting there. Then put your meat in. It will drop for a bit and then it will start to come back. Only then go to bed when you're happy that the egg is at a set temperature and it's not going up or down. you've got to know it's there, but make little adjustments. Don't make big adjustments because it'll end up catching you out. If you've got a wireless meat thermometer, use that, something like the meter that you can get from my site, or any of the probes that have the baby monitoring thing, and set the alarms on it. But set them, if you're going to set the alarms for the egg itself, for the temperature of the egg, set it 15 degrees or 20 degrees higher and 15 degrees or 20 degrees lower. Otherwise, you're going to have a really sleepless night and a very unhappy partner, as I learned. Anyway, right. They are good and done. So let me get a set of gloves, wherever I put them. I'm going to take these over to the table and finish them off. It's all right, I'll grab that handle. You're good. Let's get my coriander in there. Haven't used my lime squeezer, should have done that. So just to get that acidic bit in there. Got some pips, but it doesn't matter, you're going to use these. So, Thai style mussels, and the way I like to eat them, I'm just going to take the first one out. Oh, they're good. Find one with the one in the shell, and then use one of the other shells as a tweezer. Pull it, and then I like to stack them up. So while I eat all of these,
so Darren said he cooked a fry up on the egg this morning.
Yep.
Plans to wash my hands. Chicken later. Mm-hmm. Would you turn off the egg and restart it later, or leave it running on a low heat all day? I said restart it later, but that I would just check with you.
Either. No right or wrong answer. Sit on the fence. Do you want to try those, Tom? Tell people how good they are. I'll get some tissue. Yeah. Either. Doesn't really matter. So, right, Andy. They're lovely mussels. It's a shame we're not eating them straight away. But that's the beauty of this. Right. So, lots of people have asked about cooking fish on wooden planks. So, here is a wooden plank. You can see it's charred on one side, not on the other. This is one we've already used, obviously. You can use something like this 5 or 6 times before it burns all the way through. What we're going to do is we're going to cook the fish on this side. So I am going to pop it on the barbecue. Oh, here we go. And I'm just going to dry it out. So I'm popping it the side I want to cook, put my fish on, putting that down for now. And that's just so that the heat will dry it slightly. Have a look at these. I don't want to burn them. No, they're looking fab. So we'll shut that for a second. That plank has been soaking in water for at least an hour. I put it in about 7:30 this morning. I've just put it in a,
Roasting tin.
Mine went blank. Roasting tin, water in it, put the plank in, and then I just weighted it down with a bottle, just to keep it under water. People often ask me about wood chips and chunks and soaking them. I don't soak those. The reason I soak these is it stops it burning too quickly. You want it to dry out and then smoulder, but you don't want to over smoulder or catch fire, in fact, and because you want to use these planks several times. So that's why we're doing that. So this is going to take a couple of minutes at the max. So we have, and I'm going to set this up a different way as well. In fact, I could set the other egg up there. That's probably a better way of doing it. So we have some lovely sea bass fillets. Now you could do this with whole sea bass, and I have also got a nice bit of, they're all from Waitrose because it's Fish Friday. Does everyone know about Fish Friday at Waitrose? If you are a My Waitrose card holder, fish is 20% off on a Friday, so it's cheap as chips.
So, there you go. How can you cook on the plank?
What else can you cook on the plank? Fish. People do burgers, would you believe? You cook your burger and then you smoke it.
Someone
asked if you do steak on the plank. I prefer my steak with a really nice crust on it. Yeah, it's not for me, steak on a plank. Let me just put this in the bin. Yeah, weird one. Yeah, I really do only use it for fish. Right, let's flip our plank over. Can you see now it's dried out on that side? Now, what you're not going to get with a cook like this is you're not going to get really crispy skin. And that's why steak doesn't work. But what you are going to get is a nice smouldery flavour to it. So I'm just going to lay skin side down. We'll peel the fish off the skin in a bit. Skin side down on the plank. In fact, let's put that one in a minute. I'm going to put the salmon on first because it's a lot thicker. And all I'm going to add to that, and that's just so you can see the effect of the smoke. I'm just going to put a bit of lime on there. And what we'll see in a minute is it's going to take about 12 minutes to cook, 8, 12 minutes, something like that. What you're going to see on that is that the smoke will get at those bits of the, won't get at where we put, oops, try not to shut your plank in the hinge, but the smoke won't get to your, won't get to where you put the lime. So then you can move the lime slightly and it looks nice when you present it. Right, more cast iron. We're going to go to that egg end. Since it's on, it's hot, it's very hot, which is great. We'll open it up. I'm just going to get one of the glass, which I've left over at the table. Take one of those out, I'll tip it, top it. And then we'll put, I've got a half moon cast iron plancher. So we're just going to pop that in the bottom. Get that warmed up, and I'm going to cook the other bit of sea bass on there just to show you the different ways of cooking a piece of fish like that. Right, that's going, it's all good. Just give our fennel a zhuzh. Oh yeah, we're getting some caramelization now. You probably can't see this, Andy. I'll tell you what. This is what we're after, those little black caramelised bits. The tomatoes breaking up, sugar in there. It's looking good. Right, let's get that close. We want that salmon to cook. Right, blow my nose, and then we're back to this one. Morning, Chris. Chris Smith from CP Smith Stoves in Fakenham. Oh no, he's got a new name now. What's his new?
Well, I'm still saying
CP. I thought his new showroom had got a new name. Don't know why I thought that.
Mike
Morning, Mike Greasley in London. Haven't seen Mike in a while. Must be due a beer, Mike. Right, take that pan out. How different is that pan looking now? Really nice and hot. So be careful when you're doing this. Got some more. You get some oil in there, you can see instantly. Look at the smoke coming. Oh yeah, it is hot. I'll put that back in and it'll put it out. But you do want to burn the oil on there. It's just this with seasoning. So I'll pull the lid shut. That'll put the fire flames out. You're back in control. So we'll turn it down. It's got a little bit warm, that's all. But yeah, you can see that pan is getting nice and black. And the more you do it, the more non-stick it will become. And you'll see, you know, it's not, we'll have another look now. Probably. Well, now it's going to go. It's definitely going to go. still got oil in there. So do be careful when it's hot. But, you know, I could see that was going. You could see that the smoke was going. So just let that burn out a bit. I'm trying to rush it. But let's go back. Right. Now, what you're going to get with this salmon, can you see you're starting to get this sweats almost. You're starting to get a little white stuff coming out of it. This is nowhere near done yet. That is, so we will move it in a minute. But it starts to sweat a bit. You're just going to get that. That's what happens with this. It's cooked nice and quick. That's down there. Might move it up now. Haven't got space. We'll leave it there. So, over here, we should now be warming up this one. Keeping you on your toes today, Andy. Mm. Yeah, I'm going to give it a little bit more, and I'm going to season it slightly. So let's put a bit of groundnut on there. That one's not so hot. Not hot yet, but it will be. So I'm just looking at the colour of it, just to see it's clean, which it is. Getting that. So we'll let that warm up and then we'll put that on. So this is going to take, what I say, 8 to 10 minutes. I keep that open the lid. I want to keep showing you stuff. What I am going to do is get that fennel out in a second. So have a coke first. Any questions, Helena?
No, Christmas said you need car service.
Cheeky Chris Smith. If you didn't hear that, did I need the fire service? Chris is a what do they call him?
Retained
fireman. So thanks for that, Chris. No.
I've got a request to do dirty steak next week.
Dirty steak? Have we not done dirty steak? We might have done. We can do that. Dirty steak next week, okay.
Someone else has asked for beef short ribs.
Beef short ribs, not really achievable in 45 minutes. Beef short ribs is a 10-hour cook. So let's get that. So I'm not getting up at midnight to put those on. No commitment. Thanks for that, Helena. No, it's not my,
No.
We're not doing it. Right, so look at this. This thing's still hot. Stand back.
Mm-hmm.
Anything could happen. No, we're good. He says, woof. Yeah, you're going to get a bit of smoke when you do this. But what you should see, get a foil back in there. If I grab it, I'll pop it out, you'll be able to see it better. That pan is nicely seasoned. Now I've got some burnt oil around the outside. Just get your foil in that, rub it, it'll just come straight off. But that is how you season a cast iron pan. I'm gonna pop it back in, let it do a little bit more. It's possibly a bit warm at the moment. You don't wanna get it that hot. If you want to get any rubbish off your pan, that's the way to do it. Get it nice and hot and it'll burn it all off. So yeah, you want to keep below about 250 degrees. So what's Helena laughing at?
Neil Lawrence has said, beef short ribs on the table. Do it from your phone then. I'll keep quiet.
Thanks for that. So Neil Lawrence has said, cook the beef short ribs on the Traeger. So Traeger is a plug-in barbecue that you put pellets in to get the smoke. And then you control it with your phone. For those boys who've got those Traegers, it's not barbecue. No, I shouldn't say that. It is, but it's just, it's different thing altogether. Right, I'm going to get our fennel out. It's looking lush. Now I've done this a bit more quickly today because I've got the egg nice and hot. I'm just going to grab a set of gloves. Oh, we've got the other one. There. Take that out. In fact, I'm going to pop this on the level below now. Now I've got some space. Get back a set. I'm popping it down because it will smoulder. You'll hear it. Look at that. I'm probably going to regret that. But I'm bringing it over to one side just to get it away from the worst of the heat. I'm going to turn it down a bit because I don't want that pan to that plank to catch on fire. But I do want it to smoulder a bit. I do want to get some of that smoke. Right. Let's put the other bit of sea bass on it. So again, I'm going to put the smaller one on, just so, because I like sea bass done the other way. A little bit of that on. And we'll let that, another 5-10. Let that go in your eyes.
Mm-hmm.
It's smoky, isn't it? Even though you can't see it, it's smoky.
Yeah.
Right, this one. Hopefully, oh yeah, we're tiny bit of oil, nice and hot, and this is the way I like my fish. So we're gonna skin side down. I'm gonna put a little bit of salt on that. Go away, wasp. A little bit of sea salt on the skin. That'll help it crackle up nicely. And we're going straight on there. A little bit of salt on the top. And you can see it curling up. So we'll get that lid shut, but you could push it down. We're going to give that just a couple of minutes. So, any questions while we're doing that, Eleanor? No questions. I can't believe Andrew Lawrence brought up traders. Oh, it wasn't, was it Andrew or Neil? It was Neil. It was his brother, Neil, sorry. Andrew, wasn't you, it was your brother Neil, who's only just got his egg. He's only just graduated from plug-in barbecues. No, I'm joking. Traegers are a brilliant bit of kit if you want something that's completely automated. So yeah, a bit of skill in these eggs occasionally when you're not setting fire to pans and having flames rush out and
singeing the hairs on your arms.
I'm alright today. Oh no, maybe. Alright today. It's alright, I've got Chris on, he could save me. So what was suggested? Dirty steak. Yeah, we'll do dirty steak.
So Tom has asked, do you ever bother to do burn-off cleans of your eggs?
Burn-off cleans, not really. Mine don't get that greasy. I use them so much. The burn-off, if you, all you're ever cooking is big chunks, I'll turn it around. If you're doing American style barbecue, can you see this? It's gone translucent around the edge. It's almost done. You can see it's bubbling away. This is going to take seconds, so I'm going to flip it. It's almost cooked all the way through. Flip it over. We're going to give that 30 seconds on the other side. Do I do burn-offs? No, not really. And when I do, I keep it under 350 degrees. The oil, you saw it over there, will catch fire and burn off at 300 degrees. You saw it. It came shooting out the sides. So you don't need to take it up to 400 degrees. If your egg has got any moisture in it, this is my theory on it, if your egg has got any moisture in, you know, within the ceramics are porous, and then you heat it up as hot as that, it's going to turn to steam, and that steam's got to go somewhere. Hopefully it will come out. But that's why I think so many people crack fire rings, because the fire rings soak up that moisture and then people get them really hot really quick and that steam just pops them. That's my theory. That's unofficial. Right, let me get out the plate. So, that is a beautiful piece of sea bass. So we'll take it over. We'll grab a nice bit of the fennel to go with it. I like all these crunchy, crispy bits. Get a bit of that tomato on the top. Now, if you did on some of those mini potatoes, that would be great. But what you can then do is grab some of these fennel throngs, or whatever you call them.
What temp is the sea bass that's just come off?
The sea bass, the egg itself was about 200 degrees. The sea bass is cooked when the internal temperature of the sea bass, I didn't probe it, is 63 degrees. You can just see with the colour. If I flip it over, which is going to be not that easy. You can see it's opaque, it's all the way through. If I cut into it, can you see it's lovely white colour all the way through? It's not translucent. I like to leave the skin on because it's delicious. Helena, you really should have a piece of that. Poor old Andy, stuck behind the camera. Do you want me to set the camera for a second?
No, it's fine, it's fine.
We haven't got any fennel left.
What you got? Here, Andy. Go and try the fish. I'll take this.
Okay.
Here you go. We'll get them both to try some. Ooh, being fed.
Oh.
It's hot.
Stunning.
Now, I love sea bass like that.
Mm-hmm.
Crispy skin.
Oh, that's really good.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Yeah. Wood planks.
Brilliant.
So I think there's something on recommendations for wooden planks. I don't use the big green egg ones. They're pretty expensive. So what I do have, 6 extra large cedar grilling planks. Amazon's your friend. I will link these from my page, from the recipe page. You get some that are smooth and some that are rough, and it's supposed to adjust the amount of smoke. We use them all. Now, you see in this sea bass, it's starting to go white here. It's a bit translucent there. They both get this, the salmon you can see is getting an orange tint to it. The orange tinge is the smoke on the fish. Now, the way to tell, you could use a thermopen if you wanted to see how cooked it is. But what I tend to do is, if you touch it, it will start to, it's difficult to show on this, let me flip it round. One sec, Andy, whoops. Just so you can see it better. If you start to press it, can you see it starting to flake? Now the flaking means the outside's cooked. It's not flaking all the way through, so that means the middle's still pinky colour. If we probe it, 63 is cooked. So if you want that pink bit, you want to go less than 63. So if I go into the middle there, 40 something. That's perfectly safe. You can, this is, you know, you can eat, this has been frozen. You can have it sushi grade salmon. So that's perfectly safe. It'll be pink in the middle. In fact, let's give it another couple of minutes. But yeah, you can have it pink in the middle. What you don't want to do is take it too far and make it all dry and horrible, but just the other way of cooking it.
Okay, so someone's asked about, Neil Lawrence has asked about cooking a whole squid.
So I hope, I don't know if you can hear this, I'll come over and, so Neil Lawrence is asking about cooking a whole squid, not had much success with it.
He did a boiling grill recipe and it ended up like rubber.
Is this a stuffed squid?
No, I think it's just a whole
squid.
And I just simply tend to
Easiest way, yeah, just cut, the squid hood will often be flat. So just cut it around, so it's two flat bits, turn it inside out and then crisscross the inside of the squid and then fry it, just like we did with that sea bass on a piece of cast iron. And do it fast, they take seconds. It's the, by far the nicest way of eating squid. Yeah, look at that, she's tucking in over there.
You're welcome.
Let me just wash my hands. So yeah, that's how I do squid. If you're going to stuff it, then it is going to get a bit rubbery. But yeah, squid is just delicious. I bought a whole load yesterday from Waitrose for us. Smaller pieces. The big thick ones obviously are going to get quite rubbery as well, because they're, you know, it just takes more cooking. So get lots of the smaller squid. If you go to Spain, and you don't mention Spain, it'll start raining. You go to, that's a, every time we cook something Spanish, it has rained. So, but if you go to Spain, you get a lot of the smaller squid, and they're literally in the pan for seconds. You might roll them in a bit of flour, a bit like we did the salt and pepper squid. Salt and pepper
squid.
Yeah, we did squid wings,
didn't we?
By far the nicest. And I had to do it with the big stuff. If you get the smaller squid, it's a lot easier, a lot nicer. That's the way to do it.
Do you have a list, Ember, on the website of the internal temperatures of various meats?
Do I have a list of the internal temperatures on the website? Yes, I do.
Good luck finding it.
Yeah. We'll add it to the page. It's definitely there for meat. Fish is all 63. I don't know if it actually has feet. It's from a great website called amazingribs.com, run by a guy called Meathead Goldwyn. He's got books as well, but I stolen his temperature chart. It's fabulous. You can actually buy it as a fridge magnet. But yeah, brilliant chart. It's up there for all the different cuts. It's what I use. I'll link it from the recipe page. I'll make sure that's up there. Right, let's have a look at this, otherwise we'll overcook them. So, oh yeah, I'm gonna take this off. That one is done, definitely. This, can you see this is flaking as well? You can see it's got, if I peel it back, you can see the difference in colour. And it's just gonna be more smoky, so let's take these off. Best way, any of you had your egg, I'm not gonna find them now, am I? For years and years, can't find one. There is what's called a grill gripper. Oh, I've got one. The egg used to come with these. You can still buy it. It's a bit rusty, it's a grill gripper. The idea was, you put it through the grid like that and you were able to lift your grids off. Nobody buys them anymore, but because everyone gets half moons. But if you've got one of those, get it underneath your plank. It's the best tool to lift it off with. Now, whatever you do, if you want to have a look at the bottom of that, it's burning. Don't put it on a wooden table. So put it on a trivet, put it on a something, a bit of foil. Just don't put it on your dining table. It will make a right mess. It has been done. But I might. I'll just put it on top of there. Okay. And what I'm going to do, I drag all of this over. Cut a little bit of that fish, that salmon, so you can see it. Purpose these little limes, I peel them off. I don't know if that works on Instagram. Can you see this is orange and that's pink, and then it's pink and then orangey colour. And that's just how much the smoke has touched that. And if we cut through the middle, if you can see, if I'm pushing it, it's flaking. It's not in the middle. I want this to be pinkish. Let's take a chunk out. Oh, I've got the skin. Oh, I am not very good at this. That is absolutely spot on. For me. Get the mussels out of the way. You just got to leave the skin on the plank. Just remember that. You don't want this skin because it's all rubbery and chewy and horrible. I'm not the best at presenting salmon. I'll do the same with the sea bass, so we'll take that out of the skin. Cut it down the middle, we'll take that off as a, it'll come as a whole fillet. There's bits there. Alright, get in there with your fingers. Oh, that's nice. Bit of lemon squeezed over it. Let's get the rest of the sea bass up there. What are you laughing at? What are you guys saying about
nothing,
me?
Nothing. I'm just thinking that's why you're not on MasterChef.
Oh no, it does look like a dog's dinner, but you know. Oh,
try it.
Try the salmon, try the sea bass. Very subtle smoke to it.
Oh yeah.
But that's how we go.
That's good.
I'll have a bit of this since I haven't had any. Oh, I love this. You've got to try this. Anyway.
That's a reminder, next week.
So, let me just wash my hands, finish this mouthful. This is why they never eat on live TV, isn't it? You can't talk and eat at the same time. I should say, once you've taken all the salmon off, I won't do it, but once you've taken it off, leave the skin on, or you can scrape it off with a knife. These cool down quite rapidly, obviously, because I've just picked it up. But once you take the worst of the skin off, just soak them again. And I just use a Brillo pad to then just take the rest of the skin off, and then you can reuse these. So keep them, that'll do another 4, 5, 6 cooks, something like that. So next week, we've got a cook next Saturday. If you want to buy anything, get your orders in early, because we are going to shut the shop from, we might not shut the shop, we won't just won't ship anything from next weekend for about 10 days. We're going on holiday. So the following week, we probably won't do a class or do one of these, because we'll be on a campsite in deepest, darkest Cornwall, and I don't think the reception's good enough to do one of these. So you'll have to have a week off. But if you do want to buy anything, let me know. I'm going to get an update from Big Green Egg, hopefully on Monday, as to when things like plate setters and pizza stones and all that lot are coming, because they haven't updated me lately. For those who've asked it, I will let you know. What else do we have to say? Yeah, we've got a few Let's Queue rotisseries left, but not many. I will get a load more, but I won't get them delivered till we get back. Oh, and some new products coming, but I'm not going to tell you what they are yet. So we'll have some new stuff as well coming out, so you just have to wait and see on those. But otherwise, yeah, feel free to ask any questions. Do suggest what you might want to see along with the steaks next week. Everyone does love steaks.
Some people have asked about dirty veg, so I thought
about
doing dirty.
Oh, we'll do the dirty cat. Let's do a dirty day on Saturday.
So I'm in.
So we will do the dirty carrots. So Christian Stevenson, DJ Barbecue, will do his dirty carrots with a bit of a twist. Again, it's a good one with cast iron, so a bit of a theme going there. But let's take one last look at that pan. It's pretty much back to black. Bit of burnt oil. So if you just...
That's gonna be
that nice. Goes through you, doesn't it?
Oh, yep.
Bit of towel in there, I'll just give it a wipe. Well, just compare the top and the bottom. Totally different. So don't fret. If you ever get anything cast iron and it's gone rusty because you've neglected it, I think that's been used in 2 years. It looks almost new. Bit more oil, it will look stunning. Yep. So thank you again for watching. If you need to get hold of me, all the details are on the website, nick@meatsmokefire.co.uk.
Take pictures, tag you.
Take pictures, tag us. We love seeing what you've cooked. Hopefully you've enjoyed today's session. Thanks for watching again, and we'll see you next Saturday, same time. Cheers.